So, in this last video segment, I'm going to talk about how to do aggregate demand, aggregate supply problems. And just like with normal supply and demand problems, I would really encourage you to follow a sort of set of steps here to try and get you to walk through the problem systematically. I've noticed over the years that when students don't sort of follow this disciplined set of steps, they often kind of jump to the punchline and then come and circle back around and they get all confused. And it's especially a problem in macroeconomics because everything affects everything. So, first thing to do is draw your axes and initial aggregate demand, long-run aggregate supply, and short-run aggregate supply curves. And label all those things. Label the axes, label the curves. Identify the initial equilibrium. Second step is typically there's going to be some kind of event that comes along, something that's going to knock us out of our equilibrium. So decide which curve or curves the event affects. Shift the affected curves appropriately, where you want to remember left is less, right is more. Four, find the new short-run equilibrium at the intersection of short-run aggregate supply and aggregate demand. And then finally, five, find new long-run equilibrium at the intersection of long-run aggregate supply and aggregate demand, and figure out where to draw short-run aggregate supply so that it also passes through that intersection. So let me go ahead and walk through an example of all this. So let's suppose we're going to have our economy here, and it is, say, 2005. The economy has recovered from the recession after the busting of the dot-com bubble. And so we are at our Goldilocks moment here, where we're right there, either in a recession or a boom. So I've drawn my axes, I've drawn my curves, I've labeled them, I'm going to identify my initial equilibrium, and my initial equilibrium has prices there at P1, and GDP is equal to long-run aggregate supply at its natural rate. And then the housing bubble begins to heat up, and that causes increases in aggregate demand. So I'm going to have aggregate demand curve 2. So I decided which curve to shift, the aggregate demand curve, and I decided this is an increase in aggregate demand. People are buying and producing more goods and services, and left is less and right is more, so I shifted right. So I went from my initial equilibrium here to my new short-run equilibrium here. And so we have higher GDP, and that also means lower unemployment. So for a while there, towards the end of the housing bubble, the unemployment rate got below 5%, so that was pretty high. And inflation started heating up. Now, in the particular case, that bubble popped violently because we had a financial crisis. But let's go ahead and think about what would have happened if we hadn't had that violent popping. So if we hadn't had that violent popping, what would have happened here is we would have had really tight unemployment, okay, low unemployment. We would have had fast nominal wage growth. And potentially, firms would sort of catch on to this misperceptions thing. They would sort of go, oh, inflation's happening. And it's not just that the demand is growing for my product, it's also that the price of all my inputs is going up. So eventually, my long-run equilibrium with that level of aggregate demand is over here. It's at the intersection of long-run aggregate supply and aggregate demand. So eventually, as firms realize that their input prices are going up and as their labor costs are going up, eventually we would get back to something really annoying where the red pen doesn't work. We would eventually get back to short-run aggregate supply here. So maybe this was short-run aggregate supply 2005. And maybe if there hadn't been a financial crisis, this whole bubble would have sort of calmly there would have been inflation and the bubble would have sort of gone and resolved itself eventually. So that would be one particular scenario out there. Let me go ahead and do another scenario. Let's suppose that we have a sudden and beneficial drop in the price of some crucial raw material. Maybe it's something like oil, maybe, you know, it's fracking has driven down oil prices suddenly in a way that no one foresaw. Maybe it's something else out there. But if we have a decrease in our raw material prices, then we're going to have an increase in short-run aggregate supply. So we're going to shift out here to short-run aggregate supply 2. And what we see here is that this causes both lower prices and higher income. So we go from P1 to P2. Income, output, GDP are all synonymous, of course, in a macroeconomy. So we're going to have this burst of economic growth here, and we're going to go ahead and have lower unemployment. But again, that lower unemployment is potentially going to mean that wages are going to grow faster than normal. And as wages grow faster than normal, production is going to be less profitable, and we're eventually going to end up back here at P1 again. So this one's actually going to be both P1 and P3. What we're going to see if we keep on running through all these is a couple of things. Shifts in aggregate demand. If it's a fall in aggregate demand, then it's going to produce lower prices and lower output, which is also the same thing as higher unemployment. If it's a rise in aggregate demand, has the opposite effects. It's going to tend to cause inflation to be more of a problem, and we get the side benefit of higher output. So shifts in aggregate demand almost always balance some good with some bad. Shifts in short-run aggregate supply, on the other hand, are either all good or all bad. If it's a decrease in short-run aggregate supply, a leftward shift, then we're both going to have higher prices and lower GDP, higher unemployment. If it's a positive, beneficial shift in short-run aggregate supply, then we're going to have a rightward shift in short-run aggregate supply, and that's going to lead to lower prices and higher GDP. So, generally speaking, we're fairly confident that we can do something about aggregate demand shifts, as we'll see later when we talk about fiscal and monetary policy. Exactly what our response should be to short-run aggregate supply shifts is a little bit trickier.